Bibliophiles of the Internet, my name is Avery, and today I'm here to bring you my November wrap-up. To catch you up on things that happened in November, the Faze and Gaze Book Club graciously invited me as a guest to their live show discussion for Cemetery Boys. It was a really nice chance to get to talk about some of the finer points of the story, including some spoilery stuff, so if you want to watch that, it will be down below. It was also my 7th BookTube anniversary on November 22nd, so I made a special video about 7 lessons I've learned from being on BookTube that will also be down below if you would like to check that out. And being the clown that I am, I forgot to mention last month that the Quiet Pond kindly invited me to do an interview with Joss from Scribbles Reads as part of their Latinx Heritage Month celebration, so that link will also be downstairs. And it was Trans Awareness Week in November, and I did a trans Q&A on my Instagram, which I saved as a highlight. That will also be, you guessed it, down below, and I might be biased, but I think it's pretty cute. I think that's everything. As you may know, November was Indigithon, Tome Topple, and Nonfiction November, and I tried to do a little bit of everything, so let's just get into it. The first book I listened to, courtesy of Libro FM, was Black Sun by Rebecca Roanhorse, read by Kara G, Nicole Lewis, Kaipo Schwab, and Sean Taylor Corbett. I buddy read this with Starla, whose channel will be down below. It's an Own Voices, Indigenous-inspired epic fantasy set in a reimagined pre-Columbian America, and all eyes are on the holy city of Tova, where the winter solstice is going to coincide with a rare solar eclipse. This is known as the Convergence, and it's been foretold to be an unbalancing of the world. At the same time, a ship launches from a distant city bound for Tova, and it carries a strange passenger who claims that his destiny is to arrive in Tova and unleash a reckoning at the hour of Convergence. Content warnings for some descriptions of emotional and physical abuse, physical assault, graphic injury, self-injury, and graphic violence, allusions to ableism, homophobia, child sex slavery, sexual assault, and familial loss. Before I get into it, I did want to point out that most of the characters in this story are queer, there are characters who are trans and two-spirit, and one of the characters has a non-binary love interest who uses neo-pronouns, which is pretty fucking neat. This was such an amazing read, and honestly, I don't know how much there is to say because Rebecca Roanhorse has never written a bad thing in her life, and most likely never will, but this was just fantastic. What I love about her books is that she takes these really ambitious, imaginative concepts and makes them feel so real and approachable. She really grounds you in the story and gives you a concrete way to connect with her characters. Obviously, multiple POVs are nothing new in fantasy, but I love that each perspective is distinctive and woven together so intentionally, and also how the structure of the story itself echoes the overarching timeline, because it's not just a convergence of sun and moon, but a convergence of all these different lives in one place. And every last detail of this fantasy world is a huge middle finger not only to colonialism but to Western-centric and Eurocentric fantasy, which is all too often shown to be the norm for all fantasy worlds and stories. From the clothing to the economy to the way ships are built and the way food is prepared and even the way social, political, and religious hierarchies are set up, the uncolonized nature of this world is so clear and so deliberate. And each and every one of these characters obliterated me, not only as their mythology, magic, political intrigue, and mystery, but each and every character is deeply emotional and written with so much depth that you can't help but feel invested in everything they want to accomplish. When they're hurt, you feel it. When they're betrayed, you feel it. You want them to succeed, even if you don't know whether they're villain or hero, or if they completely exist outside of those constraints. Rebecca Roanhorse just perfectly balances all of these different storylines and conflicts in what is truly an unforgettable start to a very promising epic series. The one thing I will say is that the buildup doesn't quite pay off in the climax. The whole story is building up towards this day of convergence, and then it happens very quickly just to get to the setup of the second book, but I still love this, and I gave it 4.5 stars. After that, I listened to Alatsue by Darcy Little Badger, illustrated by Ravina Kai and read by Kinsale Houston. I buddy read this with Joss from Yogi with a Book. Her channel will also be down below. It's an Own Voices YA contemporary fantasy set in a version of America where myths and magic are very much real, including the legends and stories of indigenous peoples. Our main character, Alatsue, is Lipan Apache and asexual, and she can raise the spirits of animals. When her cousin is suddenly killed in a mysterious car accident, Ellie suspects that it was actually murder, but the picture-perfect town of Willoughby has already dismissed the case, so it's up to Ellie and her friends to uncover the truth and unearth Willoughby's secrets. Content warnings for references to murder, injury, and vehicular trauma, exploration of death in the family and pet death, allusions to genocide and kidnapping, as well as some violence and assault. As I've mentioned before, Brody did a fantastic review of this book, and so did Melida from The Midnight Librarian. Both of those will be down below. They are not Lipan Apache, but as indigenous book reviewers, their perspective is closer than mine, so definitely check those out. I had a strong suspicion that I would really enjoy this book, but it still blew me away not only with its beauty and its thoughtfulness, but also its fun and adventurous spirit. This is such a good mystery. As Joss and I were reading it, I was telling her that this is one of those mysteries where the more that's revealed, the less I actually know, and it kept me guessing a up until the very last seconds. And that mystery is sort of fueled and intensified by knowing there's something deeply wrong with the town of Willoughby, but people being unwilling to see it or name it for what it really is. I also love how everything is normal in this world. There's vampires and fairies and monsters and spirits, yes, but also like her best friend Jay is a cheerleader and it's super chill, and also everyone knows that Ellie is ace. Both of those things would usually be seen as a disruption of the quote-unquote norm, but they're very much non-problems in this book. Everything is real, everything is normal, everything exists, and everyone's just cool with it, which is badass. And I also really appreciate how the story incorporates indigenous magic and storytelling while not feeling the need to perform to those things. Like how it's very clear that Ellie can summon the spirits of animals, but we're never told how she does it. And that's fine, because we don't need to know. Some things are sacred, some things are secret. The story also shows how there's power in connection to the land, in connection to your ancestors, and also the structure of the story itself emulates the values of indigenous storytelling because it doesn't always go in a straight line from point A to point B, and yet everything has a purpose. There's a line which Brody pointed out in their review which says, "Don't rush stories, that's sacrilegious." So even though there are these little narrative detours, it's all adding to the story and it all comes together in the end and makes sense. I mean it when I say there is no detail that is forgotten or wasted in this story. It all comes back in the end, and that's part of what makes it such a successful and satisfying book. This story is deeply traditional, but also refreshing. It's fun, it's wholesome, it has a dark and interesting mystery at its center. It's a great commentary on cultural responsibility and also the entitlement people feel over native lands and native bodies. Even though it is sad at times, it never loses sight of hope and love, and that's exactly why I gave it 5 stars. After that, the one thing I read that was not for Indigathon was my arc of These Violent Delights by Chloe Gong. This just came out on November 17th from Simon Teen. It's an Ohm Voices historical fantasy and reimagining of Romeo and Juliet. Except the story is ripped from the streets of Fair Verona and dropped into 1920s Shanghai, and the main characters Juliet Tsai and Roma Montagov are the heirs of rival gangs, the Scarlet Gang and the White Flowers. While the two gangs are locked in a constant battle for power and territory, a mysterious disease begins to ravage the streets of Shanghai that causes people to mutilate themselves uncontrollably, and also sightings of a monster lurking in the Huangpu River begin to surface. So Roma and Juliet realize they have to put their blood feud on hold and work together if they hope to save their city from tearing itself apart. Content warnings for graphic descriptions of blood, gore, violence, body horror relating to insects and self-mutilation relating to illness, exploration of contagious disease, illness and familial death, and descriptions of murder and gun violence. This book absolutely destroyed me. I am angry about how good it is, and the ending kept me up way past midnight and left me silently scream whispering into the void. I suffered, I loved it, and I would do it again in a heartbeat. Shakespeare himself would be quaking in his boots, and he never in a million years could have anticipated a retelling quite like this. It is so well written, so sharp, so intense, so bloody, and entirely its own story in every imaginable way. I also want to point out that you don't need to know anything about Romeo and Juliet to understand or enjoy this story, but I think if you are familiar with it, like I am, that almost makes it better slash worse, because you know the major beats of the story, but you have no idea how the author is gonna get there or which direction she's gonna take. I love the historical setting of this story because I found it to be authentic and thoughtfully portrayed, and the political backdrop especially really added to the intensity of the story and heightened the narrative stakes. The thing about 1920 Shanghai was that it wasn't simply a Chinese city populated by Chinese people, but actually had various political factions and populations of foreigners waiting to occupy various parts of the city at the first chance they got. There was a struggle between nationalist and communist factions, and also coalitions of British, French, and Russian populations all trying to leverage power over the city itself. So to have that in the background further aggravating the tension between these two fictional gangs really makes the story that much more urgent. Because then it's not just about these two gangs trying to conquer each other, but they're both being overwhelmed by this mysterious and highly contagious disease, and this is exactly the kind of moment their enemies have been waiting for to finally seize control, which neither gang wants. So the stakes are very high, and getting to the bottom of this mystery is very much rooted in politics, power, and influence, and I think the story thoughtfully comments on all of those things. And the characters are ruthless and dynamic. They're all interesting to read about, and they all have some desire to prove their worthiness and loyalty to either their family or their gang, and they're willing to put everything at stake. The dynamic between Juliet and Roma especially was absolutely electric, because there's history between them, there's trauma between them, and the trust between them has been broken over and over again, and yet the other person is their only hope in this dire circumstance. They can go from kissing each other to killing each other in seconds, and the intensity of that push and pull, will they, won't they dynamic only makes their partnership that much more interesting and intense. It's also fascinating to see how they navigate having to help their enemy in this crisis while also not knowing how much to trust the other person or tell the other person at any given moment. There were also lots of overarching questions about what it means to be a monster and what it means to be monstrous, and questioning whether killing people for answers makes Roma and Juliet any better than the actual disease. So there was a lot in here about being haunted by demons, both literal and internal, and that really added another layer to the story that I really enjoyed. Overall, I loved pretty much everything about this, and I gave it 4.5 stars. Then it was Tome Topple, and I listened to Braiding Sweetgrass by Dr. Robin Wall Kimmerer, read by the author herself. This is part memoir, part manifesto, exploring the author's background as a member of the Citizen Potawatomi Nation and a scientist, specifically a botanist. So she explores all the different meanings, functions, and uses of plants and shows us how mindfulness and gratitude inherent to indigenous cultures and scientific research pertaining to climate change and environmentalism are not as unrelated as we may think. Content warnings for some discussions of indigenous trauma relating to colonialism, residential schools, Indian agents, forced relocation, genocide, murder, animal death, and racism. There is so much heart and so much wisdom packed into this one book, and it totally blew me away. Not only is it beautifully written with a poetic touch, not only is the audiobook narrated in such a strong and measured voice, but there is just so much you can take away from this book. It is a direct attack on capitalism and market economy, but also explores how we can exist as mindful and empathetic people within those systems, how we can challenge those systems by redefining our relationships with resources, and ultimately it's about healing the divide between Earth and humans. The title Braiding Sweetgrass comes from the symbolism of sweetgrass in the Potawatomi creation story and how braided sweetgrass is used in ceremonies and rituals as something sacred, and she begins by explaining the significance in braiding the sweetgrass as a collective, deliberate act. Braiding is something that usually takes more than one person, it takes time, it's about weaving together things that were previously separate and making it into one piece, and that perfectly outlines the structure of the book. Each chapter is made up of 3 parts. The overall subject could be a plant, a fruit, a tree, some other living object, and then she'll explain its growth and its function in scientific terms, its connections to indigenous values, and then she'll connect it to a story from her own life, and she weaves together all 3 parts. It is done so well, so beautifully, so intentionally, that after finishing the book, you realize that none of those things could exist without the others. Everything is so intrinsically connected, and that's the point. And what I really appreciate about this memoir is that Dr. Kimmerer is open and willing to share her experience with her culture, formative stories she's heard, wisdom she's learned, but she is not advocating for the wholesale appropriation of indigenous lifestyles or values. She's not saying, this is the way my people understand the world and walk through the world, and everyone should do it exactly this way, and to interpret it that way would be, like, disgusting and disingenuous, but rather she's showing us that there are universal tenets of gratitude, reciprocity, and mutualism that everyone can use. And reciprocity is a major theme throughout this book, and it challenges what the typical American thinks of as a reciprocal relationship. For a lot of people, it's this idea of an eye for an eye, or you scratch my back, I scratch yours, or in terms of environmentalism, as long as I plant a tree, I'm doing my part. But true reciprocity is not just you do something for me, I do something for you, but rather you see me, I see you. You nurture me, I nurture you. You listen to me, I listen to you. You take care of me, I take care of you. You heal me, I heal you, etc., etc. As she says, the relationship between human and earth is very much broken, and this memoir takes you on a journey to try and heal that relationship. It is one of the most profoundly beautiful, stunning, and moving memoirs I have ever read, and I gave it 5 stars. Then my Patreon pick for November was This Place, 150 Years Retold, which is a comic anthology written and illustrated by many different Native creators with a foreword by Alicia Elliott. This is sort of a collective retelling of the last 150 years in Canada, told from the perspective of Indigenous peoples. The stories highlight unsung Native heroes, historical figures, or happenings, as well as magic, surrealism, and futurism, and shows how Indigenous peoples have been surviving a post-apocalyptic world ever since contact. Content warnings for explorations of trauma relating to colonialism, residential schools, family separation, assault, child abuse, suicide, racism, Indigenous slurs, some allusions to death and cannibalism, and some graphic depictions of violence. This was such an amazing collection of comics, so many different voices, perspectives, and methods of storytelling, and it's kind of rare to feel this way about any anthology of short stories, but each and every piece felt complete. And I think it feels that way because each comic is fully contextualized beforehand by a short introduction where the author will tell the audience what this story means to them, where they learned about it, why they wanted to write about it, and maybe even their own research or resources. And then that's followed by a comprehensive timeline outlining historical events, laws, and other contexts that might otherwise completely be missed or lost. So because you're fully informed before going into every comic, all of them make sense, they feel very focused, and you have a clear understanding of what the storytellers are trying to accomplish. As I said in the synopsis, many of these stories are dedicated to historical figures or historical happenings that colonizing countries have tried to erase, so it's really great to see those stories be reclaimed and retold, even if the telling of it is painful because they have historical and cultural significance. In every way, this anthology is about Indigenous resiliency and power. I thought it was really beautifully and thoughtfully put together, and I gave it 4.5 stars. And the last thing I read in November was Son of a Trickster by Eden Robinson. It's an own voices YA contemporary story with a touch of surrealism. It's about a kid named Jared who's part of the Heiltsuk Nation, I believe, and his family pretty much sucks. His parents are divorced, his mom dates a bunch of deadbeat guys, and his dad is an alcoholic and drug addict who burns through all his cash. So basically, Jared's in a tough spot, and he takes it upon himself to take care of his parents and help them as best he can, which is how he gets into selling drugs to basically help them make ends meet. Obviously, as a teenager, he's having a hard time keeping everything afloat, and sometimes he blacks out and loses time completely. And he's also realizing that he can maybe speak to birds, whether he's using drugs or not. Content warnings for drug abuse, alcoholism, abuse, child neglect, physical assault, graphic violence, animal abuse, animal death, explorations of poverty, use of derogatory slurs, racism, some graphic descriptions of sex, sexual language, self-harm, suicide attempt, and allusions to predatory adults. Full disclosure, I'm still reading this book as of filming this video, so I can only tell you what I think of it so far, but I've been pleasantly surprised by this book. It is deeply fucked up and has a lot of dark and triggering content, as I just mentioned, but it's surprising me with its dark humor and sarcasm and levity, which I wasn't expecting. As a survival tactic, I would think, Jared just lets a lot of stuff roll off his back. He's not bothered by anything, you know? He doesn't hold grudges, he's very realistic, he's resigned to his family being what it is, and even though he is a teenager and makes a lot of bad choices, you still get the sense that he's trying to do the right thing, or whatever is the least awful thing given the circumstances. Jared is definitely destructive and forced to deal with predatory adults who want to take advantage of him and his willingness to help others, but I just feel so much for him and I want so much for him, and those are exactly the kinds of characters I really enjoy. Going into this, I was very conscious of how drug abuse, drug infiltration, and alcoholism are very real issues affecting Native nations, so I'm hoping the story ends up challenging that further, and I'm definitely keeping a very careful eye on that dynamic. I also appreciate how the structure of the story emulates Jared's developing conflict with possible magic because it jumps around from place to place and doesn't always seem to fully connect, which very much echoes how Jared loses time and struggles to navigate on a day-to-day basis. There's also this kind of building relationship between the two things because the harder Jared's life gets, the stronger this potential magic gets, and the closer it comes to the surface. Like I said, I'm not done yet, so I don't have a final verdict to share, but Marinez and Paige both did really wonderful reviews for this book, which I will link down below, and you should definitely check those out if you want to hear more about it from people who have actually finished it and have coherent thoughts. Again, I'm not done, but I have a feeling this book is going to be like a solid 4 stars. So those are all the books I read in the month of November. It was another fantastic reading month, and I hope December is just as good. If you have any thoughts on any of these books, feel free to share that in the comments below. But that's everything I had for this wrap-up today. Until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.